Hi everyone. In the previous video, we reviewed what exploratory data analysis is and how we could use summary statistics and visualization to extract important insights from the data. In this video, we will gain hands-on experience of loading this anxiety attack data and perform exploratory data analysis. We will ask questions which can be general, such as asking about data shape and data type and column names. Are there any missing values? And what do we want to do with these missing values? What are the distributions of predicted and target variables? And are there any outliers in the data? We will also ask specific questions such as what factors are most strongly correlated with anxiety severity? Are there any specific symptoms that are most common in higher severity levels? Which symptoms are most prevalent in severe anxiety levels? And which features are most important for predicting anxiety severity? We will use Plotly for visualization and to see if these visuals provide any useful information to answer these questions. This is an important video, so please watch till the end as you might learn new Pandas functionality and also about the Plotly plots. Also, if you like the content on my channel, please like and share and consider subscribing for latest updates and videos. Thank you. Let's now work on the notebook. Okay, so the first thing that we need to do is to import the necessary libraries. So here we are importing Pandas as PD, and then we are using Kaggle Hub to download the data from Kaggle and Plotly Express for plotting. Here we have .env to load the environment variables required to access data from the Kaggle website. This is the code I used to download the data, and this is the data that I downloaded: anxiety attack factors, symptoms, and severity. The data will be loaded into this path. Once we print this path, we could then go into that location and copy the data to a desired location. Here, I have already copied the data to this directory. So that's the data file path. Now, I am using read_csv method to read this CSV file. And now, let's use the head method to see the top 5 rows of this data frame. Here, we can see there are many columns: age, gender, occupation, sleep hours, dizziness, medication, and the severity of anxiety attack, which is a scale from 1 to 10. Once we have the data, we typically ask some general questions about the data. So what is the structure of the data set? That is, we want to know the number of rows, number of columns, what are the column names, and what kind of data these columns contain. We can also ask if there are any missing values. If yes, so what is our strategy? Do we want to impute these missing values or drop the affected columns or rows? We are also interested in knowing if there are any duplicate rows, how many, and should they be removed from the data set. Another important question is to understand the distributions of predicted and target variables. And we are also interested in knowing if there are any outliers in the data. We can find the number of rows and number of columns using the shape of the data frame. For example, here we have 12,000 rows and 20 columns. We can also use the D types to list the types of each column. Here we can see that we have the name of the columns and the corresponding data type. So if we look at these, we have these two columns as floats. Some of these columns are objects, and the rest of the columns are int 64. We can also gain more information about the data frame or the data set using the info method. Now we can see the same information that we have 12,000 entries, and the index starts from 0 and it goes to 11,999. There are 20 columns in the data, so these are the column names, and the total number of non-null values are 12,000, so there are no missing values, and these are the data types. And we also see how many columns have specific data type. For example, float 64, there are only 2 columns that have this data type, and there are 11 columns that have the type of int64, and there are 7 columns that contain strings or Boolean values. We can also verify if we have missing data using the isNull method, and we can change the any method to see the Boolean array. Here we can see that all of these columns are showing false to isNull, so there is no missing value in the data. Next question is to find the duplicate values. If there are any rows that are duplicate in the data, we could find those rows using the duplicated method. And again, we can use the any method to identify whether we have duplicate rows or not. Here, we don't have any duplicates. Then another useful trick is to separate out the numeric and categoric data. So we could do so as well using the select D types. For numeric, we provide the include equals to number in the list. And then in categoric, we provide object, category, and bool in the include list. This is our data frame with categoric columns only. Here we can see that we have 7 columns. Now let's look at the numeric data. And we can also use the head method to only list the top 5 rows. And here we have columns age, sleep hours, physical activity, caffeine intake, alcohol consumption, stress level from 1 to 10, heart rate, breathing rate, sweating level, therapy sessions, diet quality, and severity of anxiety attack. We can use the value counts method on the categoric variables to count the values. This shows us how many values does a specific gender, occupation, smoking, family history of anxiety, dizziness, medication, and recent major life event combination can have. In this case, for example, we have an unemployed male, non-smoker, no family history of anxiety, no dizziness, no medication, and no recent major life event. In our data, there are 209 entries that belong to this category. We can also do some visualization on the data. Here we are creating another data frame. For the gender column, we do the value counts and reset the index. And then we rename the columns to gender and count. This is how the gender counts data look like. By looking at this data frame, we can see that we have almost the same number of female and male genders, but the other gender is underrepresented in this data. And we could verify this using a bar chart on count and gender. And we could clearly see there are more female and male gender values than the other gender in the data. If we want to use a machine learning algorithm to predict a variable, we need to carefully think of a strategy how to deal with this underrepresentation of the other gender. We could also use a pie chart to visualize this data distribution. And we could see that male and female gender values are dominant in this data. Only 3.9% of the data belongs to other gender. Now, in the previous video, we have seen that contingency tables provide a tally of counts between two or more categorical variables. Here, we could create contingency table based on two columns, occupation and medication. To create these tables, we use the Pandas crosstab method. And we could see that we have occupation on one side expressing the rows, and then we have the number of entries corresponding to each occupation based on the distribution whether they take medication or they don't take medication. And in these two columns, I have added the values as a percentage. We could also plot a bar chart of these occupation and medication columns. And we could clearly see that for these two columns, this data is very balanced for different occupations. Similarly, we could learn about the similarity between these variables. And we have the numeric data frame. We could use the core method. This will give us a 2D matrix of cross-correlation values between different columns. And looking at these values, we can say that these values are very small and close to zero. So there is no correlation between the columns. We could plot a scatter matrix of some of the columns. And this also shows us that there is no correlation between the variables. Again, we are doing the contingency table for the gender and occupation columns here. And again, we could see that data for female and male genders are very balanced, whereas the other gender is underrepresented. Violin plots are used when you want to observe the distribution of numeric data, and these are especially useful when we want to make a comparison of distributions between multiple groups. Here we have severity of anxiety attack on y-axis and medication on x-axis, and we color by gender. We can see from the violin plot that the data is very similar and uniformly distributed. We can also create a box plot on sleep hours. And here we could see that the median value is centered between the two quartile values. This shows the data has no skew. We can create a similar box plot for the caffeine intake. And again, the data shows no skew. We could also use the describe method on the numeric columns. This gives us the summary statistics, mean, standard deviations, minimum and maximum values, and the median values, and the first and the third quartile values as well. We could carefully review these values and know more about our data set. We could also compute the other statistics like kurtosis and skewness, and we could also use the interquartile range to determine whether the data has outliers in it or not. Besides the generic questions, we could also ask other questions like what factors are most strongly correlated with anxiety severity, how does anxiety severity vary across different demographics. For example, if age, gender, or occupation influence anxiety severity, are there any specific symptoms that are more common in higher severity levels? Which symptoms are most prevalent in severe anxiety levels? And there are so many other questions that we could ask about our data. Before we do the further analysis, let's first change the ordinal columns. Here, we want to change the age column, which is in numeric and discrete form, to the age groups children, teen, young, middle age, old, and very old. Similarly, we could assign the severity of anxiety attack, that is a scale from 1 to 10, to mild, moderate, and severe. For that, we have bin labels, a dictionary whose keys are the column names that we want to change, and the values corresponding to these keys are other set of dictionaries containing bins, labels, and the new column name. So we apply a for loop, and in that we use the pandas cut method to arrange these values into these bins. Now, if we look at the data frame, we have these two columns added to our data frame, age group and severity of anxiety attack.